Karis Painter. This is Moves Unfiltered. We explore the dance communities of Philadelphia. We learn how dance is a vehicle of culture, conveying traditions, music, and history. I'm a dancer, an advocate, a storyteller. Come with us as we explore Moves Unfiltered. And you're currently living in Argentina. Welcome.
Hi, good morning.
Is there anything else you would like to add to your bio? I know you recently became certified in stretching. Is that correct?
Yes. I took advantage of the quarantine to take a month-long certification for a stretching instructor. So I'm excited. It was a lot of work, but it was really worthwhile.
Yay. So you're joining us today from Buenos Aires, and you're going to share a little bit about your life moving here and what it's been like being an artist during this pandemic quarantine. I'm very curious. I know you used to live in the States, but you're Argentine. Is that correct? Your parents are from Argentina?
Yeah, my parents and I were both born here in Argentina, in Buenos Aires, in the actual capital. And when I was young, about 6 years old, we moved definitely. We had lived in the U.S. prior for a couple of years. And then when I was about 6 or 7, we moved to the United States, where I lived for my entire life. And I would come back and visit occasionally. And then about a year and a half ago, my husband and I moved here to live permanently.
What was that like?
It was stressful. Now that it's over, it was a great idea. It was a lot of fun, but it was something that we had to plan for a couple of years just to be able to do the paperwork for me to come back and paperwork for him to move here and live here as a permanent resident and be able to work and have a life. And then, of course, we had to wrap up our lives in the U.S. and actually physically get down here. It was a lot of work.
Did you bring lots of things? If I remember correctly, you brought a sewing machine?
Yes. We both brought two of the big international size suitcases, plus a couple carry-ons. We brought our cat. We brought both of my sewing machines. We brought a guitar. My husband is a chef, and so we brought all of his knives and kitchen implements.
Wow, that's pretty wild. What was your thinking on bringing the sewing machines?
So everything that is imported in Argentina is incredibly expensive, more than double the price than what it would be in the U.S. And one of my sewing machines I had gotten when I was in college. I had scrimped, saved, be able to afford it, and I wasn't ready to let go of it. And then the other one I had recently gotten, and it was a machine that was really expensive to replace here. And so I decided to stick them in a duffel bag and bring them.
What do you think was the biggest cultural shock or the thing that stood out to you moving here after spending so much time living in the U.S.?
Well, for me, the biggest shift was that when I lived in the U.S., I was considered very Argentine. People around me thought I was from another world. And then when I moved here, I expected to fit in more. But when I'm here, I stand out a lot as being more American.
When you say in the U.S., people said you were very Argentine. What jumps out about that?
Oh, it definitely has to be the fact that I have very little shame. It takes a lot to embarrass me. And, you know, I kind of have that loud manner of being compared to most people in the U.S. Although I did live in New Orleans, so it was more of a fit.
And now that you've been here for, what is it, almost 2 years now?
Yeah.
What would you say you miss the most?
The food.
I guess spicy food.
Yeah, I would do a lot for a pound of andouille sausage right now.
But your husband cooks. Does he cook things that you crave?
Yes, we did have red beans and rice for dinner last night. It's just not the same without some good smoked andouille sausage.
I hear you. I crave Thai food, especially Thai spicy noodles or curry.
Yeah. We did this summer and last summer, actually, we did grow our own hot peppers. So we have three varieties that grow on our terrace, rooftop terrace, under the neighbor's laundry. And we use those to do our cooking. And at the end of the season, when we have too many, they all got made into a hot sauce that we have. And
I love it.
Lasts us a little bit. And then, well,
that's it. I love it. Now, when you moved here, you immersed yourself in the dance culture here, and you were previously dancing in the States, but also, am I correct, working as a scientist, as a chemist?
I was working as a chemical engineer in New Orleans at various chemical plants and refineries on project work.
So what was it like immersing yourself even more in the classes and going out before the pandemic?
It was actually really nice because I was attempting to do the same thing in the U.S., which is how you and I met. I would travel around the festivals and classes with different instructors, and then I would show up on Monday at work just absolutely destroyed from a weekend of dancing with big sunglasses on, cup of coffee, glued to my hand, and just something I was so looking forward to. And then when I got here, and it was tough because the first month I really couldn't go out and dance because we had so much paperwork to do and we had an empty apartment and very little understanding of how to move forward. And then I started to see all the options. And when you take dance classes in the U.S., there's a couple studios, but there might only be one or two classes at your level, unless you're in a big city, maybe like New York, and you're taking salsa. But in New Orleans, we only had one or two classes a week, and that's kind of the situation in most cities outside of Buenos Aires. And then you come here, and you can choose between one of maybe 20 or 30 classes a day, even on something like a Monday, not even a day where, like a Saturday, where there's actually a lot of classes. So it was at first a little bit overwhelming to figure out which classes to take with whom, where, how those fit in. That's just the classes. Of course, there's all sorts of other dance events that you can participate in. And pretty soon it gets to be a lot.
Absolutely. You're going in and out a little bit. I don't know if it's the internet or the mic. But I guess my question then is, how did you eventually get a routine, make a routine, and find your niche and the things that called your name?
I think it took a little bit of time to figure out what I wanted to do, and it's a process. I'm still trying to figure out, you know, where I am now and where to go. Everything is always in flux here. I think for me, one thing I did was I tried to go to as many classes as possible and try to take with as many teachers as I could reasonably fit into my schedule, and then think about the people that were transmitting information that was really important to me and what I wanted, how I wanted to move forward and how everyone kind of fit into that. So I have certain classes that I take for points and being able to improve that, and I take other classes to be able to improve my connection and communication within the partnership. And then I also just have a lot of classes that I take because they're important from a historical standpoint, taking with certain teachers that have an understanding of tango in a different way and set it up from a traditional standpoint, as opposed to just movement, technique, or communication. I try to almost like a well-rounded education.
I definitely want to talk more about the history of tango and those classes, but I want to touch a little bit upon performing, because you were performing before COVID came to Argentina. Is that correct?
Yeah, I was performing at, it's a tango show called La Esquina de Homero Manzi, which is in the Boedo neighborhood. It's a very sort of central neighborhood for tango in Buenos Aires. It's Homero Manzi is a famous Argentine tango poet, lyricist, and I was performing there once a month on Saturday afternoons with another group of dancers, and then also live music, including singers. It was really a wonderful experience.
And I assume that has stopped now that there's a quarantine and the pandemic.
Yes, it's stopped completely. We can't perform because we were performing in an enclosed space, probably about 200 people. And then we've also had to stop practicing or rehearsing because of quarantine. All the practice spaces are closed and people aren't allowed to take public transportation or move about the city. So that project has come to complete standstill for now.
What do you feel has also changed as the quarantine has been lifted a little bit, but now possibly going back to being stricter? What has changed for you the most in your tango life journey, learning and dancing?
Well, before the quarantine, I had managed to rent my own space and I had a group of friends that I practiced with. And so on any given day, I might have anywhere from 2 to 6 hours of practice, maybe 4 to 5 days a week. And I was always dancing and practicing. And now that's completely come to an end. I do get to practice at home and I have classes that I take online and a lot of work that I do on my own, but basically I'm not really sharing tango with anybody else right now. A little bit sad because that's why we do it.
Absolutely. And it's almost this weird, eerie feeling that a city that had so much dancing and connection with each other, now everybody is in their own homes, apartments, and not dancing with each other.
Yeah, it certainly feels very eerie in that respect, because not only was there dancing, but culturally, we're just people who love to be together, who get together on Sundays, have family lunch. My family was constantly getting together, seeing each other at least every other week. And I haven't seen some of my family members in months because we're on opposite sides of the city and it's impossible for us to see each other. And so I think a lot of people are going through that, not just the fact that dancing is off limits, but even things like a cafe and having a cup of coffee or having a lunch at a bodegon or a like traditional restaurant, all of those things are no longer allowed and not possible to do. And I think everyone misses that.
Absolutely. And Buenos Aires never struck me as a takeout coffee culture the way it probably is, especially in the US, and that the cafes existed for a place to meet people or to read the paper and not necessarily for the actual physical taking of the coffee.
Yeah, growing up, I never saw takeout coffee here. It wasn't until I came in 2017 on my trip to settle all of the last kind of items I needed to do to move that I actually started to see go coffee. It's not culturally, it's not something that we used to do. And I still think I don't see a lot of people with coffee cups.
No. Maybe in the more posh neighborhoods of Palermo, where people also can afford now, given maybe they don't have full-time work or work at all, to buy a coffee to go, where it's probably much cheaper to make it at home.
We're much more the mate to go sort of people. You know, you do see everyone with their thermos and their mate walking around, but or their like little kit, their leather kit, but go coffee was never a thing.
It's an interesting point that you brought up mate to go, because mate is such a communal cultural element here in all of Argentina. If you could share a little bit about how the pandemic has changed that culture.
So for those of you that don't know, mate is a drink made from yerba mate, which is a relative of the holly bush. It grows up in northern Argentina, in the border regions of Brazil, Paraguay, Uruguay, and the bush is cut down and the leaves are dried over an open flame. Traditionally is an open flame which smokes the leaves. And then the leaves are cut and we drink it from traditionally a gourd, a hollowed out dried gourd, with a metal straw that has a filter on the bottom. Nowadays, you can buy mates made of plastic or carved out from wood. And then you pour hot water from a thermos over the mate, and then you drink it from the straw from out of the gourd. And everybody has their own mate concoction. So there's tons of different brands of the yerba, which is the actual plant, the tea, and then everybody adds different things. So there's people who add coffee, there's people who add chamomile is a big one, dried orange peels, dried lemon peels, and then we have what we call chuchos, which translates to weeds from a garden. And this is not so much Buenos Aires, but outside of in the rest of the country, they add what are called chuchos, which are native wild plants that they go out and pick and that have medicinal properties or different flavors, and they add those to the mate. And that's actually something that's really fun to do, is go out and into the country and try different types of mate. Because they all have different additives that they put in. But the idea, the cultural aspect is that you share one mate amongst many people. So they're typically, unless there's a lot of people, like 20, you typically only have one mate. So about any, usually it's something like 7 or 8 people share the same cup and the same straw. And so it just gets passed around and it gets, you know, a little white maybe between people, but it's a communal drinking experience. And for us, it's not strange at all to share a mate, even with people we don't know. It's actually there. It's there. I've met a lot of friends who have seen me drinking mate, and they approached me and asked me for some, and they were strangers, and then we drank mate and we were friends.
Yeah, that it's common that somebody, if you're in a group, will just pass it to you. And before the pandemic, I felt like people never thought twice about sharing I don't even know what to call it, the actual mate container. But now with the pandemic, I assume there's a different thought process on sharing.
Well, you would think that. I think people have changed culturally. I did see a photo essay of one of the hospitals in one of the biggest hospitals in Buenos Aires province. And one of the photos was table where each person had their own mate. But actually in one of the provinces north of Buenos Aires, they had an outbreak where 17 people got sick from sharing a mate. It's difficult in our culture. We're very used to being very close to people. We greet people with a hug and a kiss. They did a study in 2017 of cultures around the world, and Argentines have the least personal space requirements out of everybody they tested. We are just always used to being around each other, and we're not very squeamish about these things because we've been raised that way. And it's definitely a cultural shift to not share a mate.
Absolutely. I read that story about the outbreak outside of the capital, and I think coming from an American perspective, it's like, oh yeah, you probably shouldn't be doing this, but if it's so ingrained in what you have been doing, I can see the challenge in that and not fully automatically embracing that change.
Yeah, I think also in Argentine culture, things like sharing a mate, having a meal together, those things are really important for interpersonal relationships. And even though the situation has changed, it's difficult to cut those things out and still feel like you're being friends with somebody. That's what you do. That's how we express friendship and those relationships. So it can be quite a change.
Absolutely. I think I saw a meme about Switzerland. It was either Switzerland or Germany. And it had two people that were about 2 meters from each other. And it said, let me know when the pandemic is over or something like that, so we can go back to being 5 meters apart. As a joke to some cultures are actually, it's much more ingrained that they are distant and far apart. Versus here, I remember being in line in the grocery store, and there's somebody touching you because they're so close is common.
Yeah.
So we will take a break. I have lots more questions and want to hear more about the history of tango, especially in relation to the Black Lives Matter movement, and also what life has been like as an artist and will be as an artist in the post or during pandemic. Gimena, thank you so much. We'll be back in a few minutes. I'm Karis Painter. This is Moves Unfiltered on Ursula Media with Dylan DiRosato as our sound engineer. We'll be back.
What do you think you're doing, Kevin?
I was just gonna drive home.
There are several warning signs present that you shouldn't be driving.
Like hearing voices?
Like your text to emoji ratio?
Oh man, the selfies.
Selfie nailed it.
We all have warning signs that let us know that we're probably not okay to drive. Mine is pretending to be your subconscious.
Craig, come on, man, let's split a ride home.
Being prepared is a part of who you are. But it's especially important in the case of a disaster. Be informed about possible emergencies in your area. Make a plan that covers where you'll go in an emergency. Build a kit with the things you need to survive. There's no one more capable of planning for your situation than you. Start your plan today. Go to ready.gov/myplan.
Joined by Gimena Gordillo of Argentina, who's now living here. And she is a tango teacher, dancer, performer. And we will spend the next few minutes talking about the history of tango as brief as we can or as extended as we can. And also about life of an artist now during the pandemic. So I know you've been taking classes, learning more about the history of tango. What jumps out to you?
Yeah, so I'm actually very lucky in Buenos Aires. We have several options for taking history classes. They're completely academic classes about tango. And recently, one thing that I've been thinking about is in the context of what's going on in the United States is Black Lives Matters and how that applies to tango, because I've seen a lot of arguing, for lack of a better term, on discussions maybe on Facebook about what the perspective of tango teachers and tango organizers should be within this context and for organizing events and classes. And just somebody who's been studying history, I've seen that there really isn't a good understanding of the contributions of African traditions in tango and of Afro-Argentine contributions, cultural contributions to tango itself as well. And so I've been seeing a lot of comments like there's absolutely no relation between tango and any sort of struggle against racism. And that's actually not true in a couple different ways. So tango, the basis for the music is actually a derivative of some African rhythms that made their way to Caribbean via slavery and then made it over to Spain and then back to Argentina in the form of the Spanish zarzuela. And from there, it became tango music as we know it now. In that time, the very beginnings of tango music, there were many, many Afro-descendant musicians in Buenos Aires playing instruments, famous bandoneon players, famous flute players, guitar players here that contributed to the early roots of tango. And that's from a musical standpoint. From the dance standpoint, they're unknown, but it's generally accepted that Afro-Argentines were sort of the generators of the dance movements that later became tango, that it was really in their neighborhoods where tango was born as a dance in the very initial stages. So in the current context, say we need to separate these things out. We need to think about social problems and things like fighting racism on one hand and think about tango completely separately, it doesn't really make sense, and it doesn't really acknowledge the historical contributions to tango. I could go on more about actual way that tango was used to fight for equality for immigrants in Argentina, because there was a large wave of immigration and immigrants felt completely separate from those that had been here for much longer. And there's actually dozens and dozens of tango songs that lament leaving Italy and being here in a land where they're not seen as equals and struggling to fit into a different society. There's so many tangos lamenting the food and missing mothers and hometowns and things like that, that really speak to how tango was used by immigrants to fit into Argentine society at the time, where they were seen as outsiders. And so I think given all of these things, tango has been incredibly political throughout its entire history. And it has roots that are undeniably of an African heritage. And I think that understanding that in the context today is really relevant for tango teachers and organizers as a roadmap of how we should organize events, we should organize classes, what sort of things we should be seeking to teach in classes more than just movement or the sequences that are traditionally taught.
Could you say a little bit more about that? How do you think, or what changes could there be, especially a place like the US where people might not have the full understanding of the history or the culture?
Well, I think obviously when people go to dance classes, they go to move, they go to dance. And so we don't want to take our lessons and turn them into an academic lesson about history. But I think that encouraging an environment where people go beyond just a dance class and read different articles, different things that are available. There's a lot of information available on the internet about the history of tango. A lot of it is in English, the majority is in Spanish, but there is a lot available in English. And I think what I try to do in my classes is set an atmosphere, just little tidbits about how important it is to know the history, how important it is to understand the music and the roots. And not, I try to do it in a very fun way, not in a way that's a lecture or anything like that. But I think that it's up to tango teachers to create an atmosphere where at least the basics of tango history are imparted on students to actually understand where the dance came from, how it should look, how it should feel. And if we skip all of that, then we just get hollow sequences and movement that doesn't actually really relate to what's happening. Especially, I think it's important when you're teaching people who don't understand the lyrics to the music because of a language barrier.
What else do you think it could bring people, students, by understanding more of the history and the songs and the different, what's jumping out to me is the history and how it started big at one point and then it changed and there were these different orchestras. What do you think that could bring students?
Well, first of all, I think it'll make them better dancers. Mm-hmm. I think if you can connect emotionally the music and kind of understand the different phases that tango went through, you can over time learn how to show that in your movement and express that in your partnership. So I think that's one part of it. I think also in Argentina, we talk about tango as almost like a triangle. We have tango, for us here, has three different related aspects: They're each their own separate entity. So we talk about tango as a dance, tango as a music, and tango as poetry. And all of those three things are separate, but they're also all linked because they can't really exist without the other in a way that makes sense. So in history, that the relationship between the three has changed over time, several times. So I think that really understand culturally where tango fits in and how Argentines see tango, it's really important to be able to kind of understand the relationship between the three things and how that's changed over time and why that means certain things today. As an example, currently we only dance music from the 30s, 40s, and the early 50s, and there's specific historical reasons why, and there's specific cultural reasons why, and understanding that makes a big difference, I think, in how people relate to the music and to the dance itself.
Would you be able to share in a few minutes why do we specifically dance to those decades of music?
Sure. So there's a couple different reasons why. Most of them are actually social from Argentina. So in the biggest reason why is that in the 30s, Europe and the U.S. in the 30s and 40s were in World War II. And there was very little cultural production happening in Europe and in the U.S. due to the war, and very little of it was arriving in Argentina. And musicians, artists here were forced to up their game, basically, to start producing better quality music, better quality movies. The cinema from the 40s is some of the best cinema that Argentina has to offer. Including modern day. And so the production value had to be high, and we had to be able to produce our own cultural material. There's also other reasons, like the fact that in the 30s, we were having what would be the first generation of Argentines born to immigrants coming of age and being able to produce material in Spanish. There were, up until that point, a lot of people who were producing tango without lyrics, or the lyrics were very simple because of the fact that many of the producers of tango were immigrants and didn't have the knowledge needed to create complex poetry that goes with tango music. And even things like lunfardo, which is sort of a slang, is based on this mixture of Spanish and Italian and French words that were brought in by immigrants. And all of these things kind of come together to give us amazing musicians, amazing poets, and in a vacuum, basically, where they can produce music in a way that wasn't possible before then. Tango suffered greatly in the 20s and the early 30s, and it was competing with jazz and other rhythms that were coming from the U.S. It was difficult for musicians, and most tango orchestras of that era didn't just play tango. They played waltzes and foxtrots and jazz and other rhythms mixed in to their repertoire to be able to attract crowds. And that changed in the 30s and the 40s. It started changing.
I feel like I could listen to this all day. It's so fascinating to learn more about the history and why things are the way they are. We're going to shift and jump to now the pandemic, that Argentina put a strict quarantine on the country, which in the provinces outside of Buenos Aires have begun to be lifted a little bit. But since I believe it's what, March 20th, almost all artistic activity in shared spaces has come to a halt. So artists were, as you mentioned earlier, teaching classes during the day, performing at night, traveling to different areas, traveling outside the US, musicians, dancers, and that has stopped. So what are artists, including yourself, doing now to live, to sustain not only their art, but their health?
It's definitely been a struggle for just about everybody to be able to transition from doing a lot of work outside of the house and work outside of the country too. Many tango dancers rely on the ability to tour once or twice a year through Europe, Asia, or the US and make money and then come back here, live for part of the year and train and then go back out. It's been a struggle. There's been a lot of movement to Zoom and other virtual platforms for classes. There's been a lot of virtual festivals and sort of asking for donations. And there's even a program where if you're in the US or Europe, you can sponsor a dancer or performer in Argentina who's having trouble making ends meet. But it's definitely been a struggle here to understand we're a very art-centered culture. And especially in Buenos Aires, in the city, artists from around the country come here to be able to dance or make music or paint, produce art. And right now that isn't happening at all. And I think it's challenging to figure out how to move forward or how to stay busy in these times.
And you especially mentioned before that so much of it is enjoyed in the company of other people, that listening to live music in a space, sharing wine, sharing a cerveza with friends, with tourists, is something that is really about the fabric of the city, if not the country. And that obviously can't be fully transmitted through Zoom. How do artists, or maybe this is a general rhetorical question, how do we keep the momentum given that those things will probably not open up anytime soon?
Well, in Argentina, that question has a very different answer than it has in the US. Here, the responsibility is seen as part of the government's responsibility. The city government and the federal government sponsor a lot of institutions that are important for artists in the city, especially around tango. And right now, the general sense is that the government is really going to have to step in and figure out how to help people move forward after this is over, after we're allowed to go back to work. And I know that there are projects in the works to develop those sort of programs for when we get out of the quarantine. It's a different way of thinking about it than in the US. Art here is really seen as so vital that government is seen as having a key responsibility in making it happen and keeping it happening, especially since you mentioned tourism. Art draws a lot of people to Buenos Aires, and everything from tango itself to our art museums to our murals across the city, street music, things like that. And so it's seen as vital that the government participates in that process. I think right now everyone's still kind of in a wait and see hold to see how things develop. It looked like things were going a lot better a couple months, maybe a month ago, than they are now. And so it's kind of been a little bit of a bumpy ride.
Absolutely. We have about 5 minutes left before we wrap things up. I wanted you to share a little bit more about your teaching, because you have been teaching lessons online with, is it correct to say, Escuela Mundial in Buenos Aires? If you could share a little bit about that.
So I've been teaching some classes via Zoom at the Escuela Mundial de Tango Gabriela Elias. It's institution with a lot of history. Obviously, since the maybe the last 10, 20 years, it's was located in a very important cultural center downtown in a very beautiful and popular area. And now, due to closing down for the quarantine, the school has shifted to online classes via Zoom. And it's actually really interesting because it changes completely the way that has to be taught. There's the reality that you have to be very far from your students physically, obviously, and you can't help with your hands. You have to rely on your sight. And not only that, but you also have to take into account things like video lag and weird camera positioning. You can't tell if sometimes it's a little bit strange. And I think some people are still a little bit shy.
I have
students in my classes who you can tell are on the class, but their cameras are turned off or they're pointed at the ceiling or things like that. I think, you know, kind of understanding as an instructor that people are still accommodating or are still starting to understand how to do this. You know, have to have a little patience.
Absolutely. Do you have students that are taking classes from outside of Argentina?
Yes. The classes I taught at the Escuela Mundial included people from around the world. So
hopefully sooner than later, it will be able to open up. In that building, there's also, I want to say, the Julia Boca School and I believe Dance Company is there as well.
Yes, it's the space is an art museum with several galleries. There's a theater where they have tango shows most nights of the week. And then Julio Boca is also there as well. And they're closed as well too.
So my last question, or one of my last questions, is what does tango bring to you? Why tango?
Well, I initially started dancing tango to connect with my Argentine roots. And I, along those lines, it brings a very important cultural connection for me. I feel a certain ability to be Argentine in my dance. And I also feel a lot of peace. I feel like I'm part of this historical process of society and how societies change and how art develops over time. And I really find a sense of peace and comfort in that. It also is just a really nice physical activity to get your mind off the day or whatever's going on. It's a space to be with other people and enjoy music and movement and life in a way that I haven't found in other art in quite the same way, because I was a potter for many years, studied ceramics extensively, and while it's wonderful, it's a very solitary activity, and I like that about tango, that there is a social component to it that ties everything together. And so there's a personal practice, there's a social practice, and there's a whole culture outside of it in a way that doesn't exist with other, I think, forms of art.
That's so beautiful to hear. I want to thank you for taking the time, for being here, for sharing. You're incredibly knowledgeable, not only as a dancer, a teacher, but also sharing the history and the culture. Your culture is something that I really appreciate.
For inviting me. It's been a lot of fun.
Gimena Gordillo. Is that the correct pronunciation?
It is. You got the Elie.
I have to say, before we get off the air, when I first came to Buenos Aires and people were talking about shoga, I had no idea what people were saying. And then I heard yoga with the sh sound.
With a Y.
Yes. I'm Karis Painter. This is Moves Unfiltered on Usula Media. Thank you to Dylan DiRosato, who is our sound engineer. Until next time.